Guys, good evening. Hope you all are doing wonderful. So it's been quite a long time since we have had session on Photoshop. So let me just quickly rewind like what we have done in a previous session, which was on Monday, I guess. So we have tried to understand how haze effect works. So how do we like give some vintage and old, look to a particular photograph? So we have seen how do we do that. So we have, seen an image, like green image, wherein we have seen a baby and a mother in that image. We have taken that as an example, and then we have tried to, give it an old look. So as I've told you, we do not have presets for a few, effects that we are all like following in the photo effect sessions. We do not have any presets. That means we do not have any ready-made, filters for that. So we have basically used combination of two or more techniques to achieve the desired look that we actually wanted to. So we have started with duplicating the background, of course. Then we have converted the new layer into a smart object. Then we have put up the new curves adjustment layer, and then we've got a property box with some gray waves and solid line going diagonally. And then we have some RGBs, reds and greens and blues. So in RGB, we have brightened up the shadows to give the faded effect. And the red, in the red section, in the program, we've moved the curve a bit left to make sure the reds are all aligned properly. Then we have gone to green. So we have skipped green because the image itself was green. So we didn't want to mess with that. Then we have moved down to blue option in the histogram, and then we have moved the curve a bit to the right to adjust the shadows in the image. So this basically, all these changes resulted in a very much warmer photo. Like with using the curves, we tried to wash out all the colors, and then we have tried to brighten up the shadows. And then we have tried to add some noise to the filters. Noise is nothing but basically creating a disturbance in the pixels of an image. So we've got the filters, and then we have selected noise, and then we have added the noise to the picture. Then we've added vignette. So by clicking a new layer effect button and selected gradient overlay, and some we have made few adjustments and to make sure it looked like a vintage old styled ruptured picture. Okay, so this is what we have done in the haze effect. And in today's session, so we have already completed 22 sessions so far. So we are going to learn about the grunge effect. So all that we have been doing since 4 to 5 sessions is try to learn about photo effects and techniques to make a photo look and give it a look like what we actually wanted to. So now, since we have already completed 22 sessions, now I'm going to run it over a PPT. So I want you all to practice it parallelly. So I'll be going over a PPT now. So I want you all to open Photoshop and then practice it parallelly, because this would be a very great learning for you. I'm sure you're all like practicing whatever we have been doing it in practical. But today, from today, or probably we just have a few more sessions left. So I'll just walk you over a PPT and I'll give you a brief of the steps to achieve a desired look, and please open your Photoshops and just work out parallelly. That would be like really helpful for you. So as I've told you, today we are just going to see a grunge effect. Okay, I'll just make it a slideshow. Okay, just try to observe the image out here. There are not many things basically manlier than shaving a face, right? So man basically shaves his face. So especially if you're doing with a huge steak knife, that's really a manly thing, right? But still, by looking at the picture, you will definitely have to admit that this particular picture, the man is kind of soft. The skin is almost too smooth, I can say. There are no imperfections in the skin, absolutely no flaws, right? So it looks pretty good, but it just doesn't seem to fit the context of the photo, right? So the basic context is the man using a big steak knife and shaving his face. But his face is like too soft and, you know, it's basically flawless. He doesn't have any marks or, you know, nothing. It's basically flawless. So this act that he's doing is not suiting his face. So that's what the, you know, graphic designers are there for, right? So we can create anything. We can create really amazing stuff using Photoshop techniques, okay? The main thing that you will have to focus whenever somebody gives you an image, the main thing that you will have to see is whether the image is perfect or no. Okay, a man should be like a man, a woman should be like a woman. Okay, a woman shouldn't have some flaw skin and, you know, some rough skin. Okay, at the same time, man basically shouldn't have some soft skin or, you know, some great, you know, soft edges. So this is some basic criteria or, you know, the basic things that we know, right? So you, whenever you see a picture, you will have to differentiate, like, what's wrong with the picture? Is everything right or no? Okay, based on that, you will have to select an effect to, you know, perfect the picture. You will have to choose an effect that, you know, best suits the image. So one thing we can do to this image to make it more manly is using a grunge effect. Okay, so now what's a grunge effect? So it's basically, you know, similar to the haze effect. So we went over in the previous session. So you can sometimes find it as a preset filter to apply to your photos. Okay, so but as of now, we don't have as a preset. So you will have to go through manual settings, and then you will have to create a grunge effect. So it's basically, or it's generally a combination of dark tones or glittery details, and most of all, it should be really looking some harsh. Grunge is basically an image which has some rough and, you know, a kind of rude look. Okay, so that's basically a grunge effect. So soft effect is quite opposite to that. So I'm just going to apply all these components to my, you know, image and make it look more rough. So this is what we will have to do first. Whenever you upload a picture, you will say Control O and then you upload a picture, right? So you will have your background ready. So you will have to duplicate your background. Of course, this is a basic step that we follow whenever we start with an effect, right? So because there are two things: you don't want to disturb your original image, and at the same time have an option to compare your original image with your affected, like, you know, the output. So you can either right click on your layer and then say, you know, duplicate layer, or you can drag this layer down and then say duplicate layer, or you can directly say Control J to create a new layer. Okay, so first thing, step one is like duplicating your background layer. Okay, just try to follow all the steps that I'm, you know, showing it in the PPT, and then just try to implement the same in your Photoshop. Now, step two. So I'm just going to sharpen this particular new layer. Okay, just try to understand the word. I'm just going to sharpen the layer. So what I've done is like double click here and then set, and I've just renamed this particular layer to sharpen. Okay, this is what I have done. Okay, then to actually apply the sharpness, I have gone to filter option, I have gone to sharpen option, and then I've ignored all these past options, and then I have clicked on unsharp mask option. Okay, I've just selected the sharpen layer. Okay, and then I've just got a filter, then got to sharpen, and then selected unsharp mask. Okay, contrary to what you might be like first guess, unsharp mask actually sharpens your image. Okay, see, this is how it looks. So I've selected the unsharp mask, and I've got a dialog box here. Okay, I have amount, I have radius, and I have threshold out here. Okay, so the next slider, I have taken this amount slider, and I have bringed it up to 500%. Okay, previously it used to be like 50, I've got this to 500%. Just try to observe his face out here and how it just got changed when I've tried to increase the amount to 500%. See the kind of, you know, ruggish look on his face. Okay. This seems to be basically sharpening up some details on his face, if you observe. Okay. It's not quite affecting as much of the image I actually wanted to, right? So I have then gone to this radius. Okay. This is where the radius will come into picture because not all the parts have got affected on this face. So I'm just going to the radius here. See, basically the idea is to maximize the amount of texture in the skin, right? Okay. The texture of the skin shouldn't be soft. So I just wanted to maximize the amount. So I'm just going to play with the radius. So I've just, you know, gone and then played with the radius. Okay. Till I get some enough detail. Okay. Till I get some enough detail without going overboard. So as I've slided this link forward, it's basically sharpening all the edges of my image. But if I just go too far, so these unpleasant halos started to show up in my image. So I just wanted to give you an example. So I've also taken this. So this is like a result of like over exceeded radius. Okay. So then I've toned down the radius. And then I've just got it to the normal mode. I've just seen the picture, like how it looks good. And then I've toned it down. What happens is if I just go too far, these unpleasant, you know, halos start to show up, right? Not only they do look very bad, but they also seem to be blurring the details here if you observe clearly. So I wanted to sharpen in the first place, okay? So what I've done is, like, I have gone to the radius and then I have, you know, brought it down to 5 pixels again. So I've just gone to, you know, around 40, 50 pixels, but then I've just gone down to 5 pixels. Okay, that seems to be really good. And then medium, where the details are most evident, of course, without, no, deteriorating the tones with these halos. See, look at the color tone out here, how it just got changed. So I don't see anything like that. So it's just giving me a rough look that I was expecting. So I've just toned down it to 5 pixels. It's given me a nice look. Okay, now we'll just go to the threshold option. Threshold is just here to let me reduce if I really want to, but I was actually happy with this tone. I'm sure you agree with me. So I'm just happy with this tone. So I have not touched the threshold. So I've just, you know, left the threshold at 0 as it is, and I've just gone up and then I've just clicked on OK. Okay. So I've just gone to filters, then sharpen, then unmask sharp. Okay, and then I've got all these options out here. Then I've just played around with amount radius, and then I've, you know, got my desired look, and then I just clicked on OK. So this is the output that I have gone. Okay, so the sharpness really worked well. But I think it might be like too sharp. Okay, so if you really observe, things really got like very rough on his face, right? So I thought to give a very, you know, a rough look to his face, but things got like too sharp. Okay, so now what I'll do is I just wanted to blend my sharpen layer with the background layer. Okay, so with the sharpness layer selected, here with my sharpness layer, this is my sharpness layer, this is my background layer. I've selected the sharpness layer. Okay, then I've gone to the blend modes out here. Then I've changed it from normal to overlay. Okay, so this is the overlay option. I'm sure you all remember, like, we have tried to use this option many times. So we have just changed the blend mode options. We have gone to sharpen layer, then we have gone to the blending options, and then we have changed it from normal to overlay. So here we go. Now this particular image is now blended with the original layer, and it's also providing some of the dark toned contrast I wanted, right? So it's giving me some dark roughish look that I really wanted. Admittedly though, the shadows have gotten too dark. If you observe, see the shadows here have really gotten too sharp or too dark that you can't even tell like his hair from you know, the background. See, the hair is completely like merged with the background. You can't differentiate the, you know, hair as well as the background, and the highlights have become too dark as well. Look at these highlights. So this is basically a highlight, right? So these have become really too dark or too bright, I can say. So I'm just going to fix this by adding new curves in the adjustment layer. Okay, so I've gone to the new adjustment layer out in the layers panel. I've just clicked the new adjustment layer, and then I've selected the curves layer. Okay, so here we go. So I've just gone to the new adjustment layer, and then here I have selected the curves. Okay. So since my sharpness layer is being blended with my original background layer, I just want these curves, okay, whatever curves I've selected, to affect only my background layer, okay? So for that, what I've done is I've just clicked and dragged my curves layer in between my sharpened layer and background layer. Okay, when I've selected my curves, so my curves layer was on the top of my all my layers. So, but I just want this, you know, curves layer to only affect my background layer. So what I've done is like I've just dragged the curves from top in so that my curves layer is in between my sharpened layer and the background layer. Okay. Since adjustment layers here only affect the layers below them, so this will make sure the curves layer will only affect my original background layer. Okay. So with that, I have also, when I've selected curves, I've also got this histogram property box. So now I'm just going to, you know, grab this. So here we go. So when I've just selected the histogram, you know, property box out here, and then I've selected, so this point will be here, right? Okay. So basically when you see, so this point, this diagonal point will be here. So what I've done is I've just dragged this, this line to a quarter of the way across the histogram. I've just dragged a quarter bit upwards in this particular, you know, map. Okay, this is like, you know, brightened the shadows of my background layer. Okay, so this is how it basically brightened the shadows of my background layer. So now I've again moved to the highlights. Okay, so here when you observe this particular option, this particular point is on the top, right? So now I just wanted to play around with the highlights. So what I've done is I've, you know, put the so this is here basically. So I've just dragged it down a bit to the quarter, okay, of the diagonal line, and I've just, you know, dragged it quarter to my histogram box. Okay, this is basically darkening the highlights of the image. Okay, now the midtones here, the midtones can also be worked upon. So what I have done is I've just dragged this to the, you know, I've sharpened few edges, I have brightened few edges. Now I just wanted to play with the midtones. So next what I've done is I've just gone and clicked in between the curves, in between the my two points, and then I just dragged it upwards to the left a little bit. Okay, this has basically brightened up the midtones a little bit, I can say, creating curve between the shadows and the highlights. So this is basically the shadows and this is basically highlights, right? So I've just, you know, put a very basic curve between the shadows and the highlights. Just remember, this y-axis is shadows, and here, this one, this line is basically highlights. So I've just, you know, toned down the highlights, I've improved the shadows, and then I've just tried to create a curve in the midtones. So this basically brightened up a little bit, I can say, the highlights. Okay, hence the basically name, you know, the name itself is curve, right? So this is basically the advantage of it. Okay, moving on. So far, so this is what I have achieved by, you know, moving the shadows, moving the highlights, and then moving the midtones. Okay, so this is the output of it. So far, this is a good adjustment. But if you observe, background is still looking too dark. Okay, especially the area on top of his head. If you observe, the hair is actually mixing up with the background. Okay, it's still so dark that it's blending with the background. Okay. When I've told you, I want to give it a grunge effect. So my goal with this grunge effect is to intensify the details and the textures of his face, okay, of this particular man. So I need to make sure that he's completely distinguished from the background, right? So this is what we will have to do, because when I look at here, whenever I'm making a change, the background is also like getting affected with that, okay? So what I'm going to do now is like mask him from the background, okay? This will also give me some more practice with the quick selection tool, of course, and the refined edge dialog box. I'm sure you remember this quick selection tool and the refined edge dialog box. We have, you know, dealt with it in the previous sessions as well. So I have selected my quick selection tools from the left menu, and then I've just dragged this. I've selected my sharpen tool out here first. I've then selected my quick selection tool. Now I've just started selecting this particular man, and then I've dragged my quick selection tool wherever I want the image selected. So I'm making sure that the background is like avoided, but you always have an option if you happen to select or go outside your selected area also, you can still select on the alt, and then you can deselect whatever you have selected outside the background. Okay, you can press and hold the alt key, and then you can deselect it. Okay, and then here my selection is like complete. I have selected whatever I really want to, and I also have a plus option and a minus option. If some things are not selected, I can go to the plus selection tool option and then select here which one is not selected. If I've selected something extra like background, then I always have an option to deselect it. Either I can press on alt, or I can go on the top options and then I can select on minus selection tool, and then I can deselect it. Okay. So I've made a quite nice selection using the quick selection tool. So this is really good. So this is the maximum that I can achieve using a quick selection tool. Okay. So next. Here we go. So I've just gone and then finished this up by going to the tool options and then select the refine edge button. Okay, I'm sure you all remember this refine edge. We have just tried this when we have tried to use this with a female with a black board background, when we were dealing with background blur option. Okay, so we have tried this refine edge option to make sure the female's hair was very smooth and then perfect. Okay, here I have selected the option, and I have lot of options in this refine edge. I have smooth, I have radius, I have contrast, and I also have this shift edge. Okay, just give me a second here, guys. Now here I'm just going to use all these sliders as I've told you, and see if I can get some better quality out of the selections. So I'm just I have just increased the radius to start with. I've increased the radius to 6. Okay. So basically I've tried to work on the radius. So I've got the radius to 6, and this is how my image looked. So this is just inviting a bit more detail into my edges, allowing the software to more loosely sample my selection out here. So just try to observe what changes have been done. It's still, of course, looking a bit more jagged, right? So here, then I've just gone to smooth. And then I've just got the smooth to 40 pixels. Then just try to see how things got changed here. Okay, this is just taking those sharp, protruding edges and kind of sanding them down a little. Not more, you just cannot observe a more huge difference. But of course, you can definitely find a little difference. Okay, now I've just gone to the feather option around here, and then I've just selected it to 3. Okay, this is just softening things up a bit more, but I can, rein the selection back into a more solid line. See, you can really find some, solid line, right? After this, I've just, bumped up the contrast to 40%. Okay. And this is really doing a great job of hauling things into a more refined selection. So now I just have a bit of black outlaying remaining in the background, right? See, kind of black outlaying out here. So you can especially see the outside edges of a skin nearest shoulders. Just try to observe this. You have a black kind of line, okay? So all these, whatever I've selected, feather as 3, contrast as 40, this is what I've done with practically. And then I felt that these options are perfect to my image, okay? The image you select might not fit all these options. So you will have to, you will have to be in a position to better define what values will perfectly suit your image. Okay, there is no, as I've told you 100 times, there is no predefined set of rules for Photoshop. It varies from photo to photo. So all these things I've taken contrast as 40 because it suited best for my image. Okay, this might be 30 for your image. Just try to play around with your options and select the best that suits your image. Okay, so then after putting the contrast to 40, then I've gone to the shift edge option out here, and then I've slided it to the left to make sure I go to negative 20. Okay. So see, my edges are kind of refined right now. That should do it through my refined edge as of now. So I'm just good with it. So next, I've just gone to my output option and I've switched that. So I've just gone to my output option and then I've switched that from selection to layer mask. Okay, it was just selection and I've just clicked here and then I've selected layer mask, because I want to use this instantly as a layer mask on my sharpness layer. Okay, then I've just clicked on OK. So just here I have an option OK, so I've just clicked on it. Okay, here we go. Now we have completely isolated him in the background in this layer, but we can sort of still see the background because I haven't applied this to my original background layer, right? So my original background layer is here, but I have not applied this whatever mask to my original background layer, but rather it's just got applied to my sharpen layer. Okay, but that's actually okay. I think I like it like this, but that's okay. So real thing, that's bothering me though, is the increase in the succeeding in making the background brighter. Okay, I think I actually made it too bright. Okay. So all these things, I've just, tried to play around. I'm just trying to see how do I give, rough look to my image. Hence, I was just playing around with the options. Okay, I'm okay with this background. It was a bit better than what it actually used to be. But it's basically too bright. Okay, so I think I'm just going to tone down the opacity of my new mask. Okay, here is my new mask. And then what I've done is like tone down the opacity. Okay, to do that, I've just selected the layer mask thumbnail out here on the layer. And I've just gone to the properties panel. And then I have like two sliders to choose from here, right? I have density and I also have this feather option. So I just went ahead and pulled this density down from 100% about a halfway. That is like 50%. Okay, it used to be 100%. So I've just dragged it down to 50%. So this is what I have achieved after that. So now the background isn't too dark or it's like not too bright, but it's just right, I can say. Okay, so my grunge effect is almost done, I can say, but it's just missing a little something. Okay, grunge effect usually have a bit of deep saturation to them. Okay, colors should be muted just slightly. You don't have to do some, you know, great variations in the colors because it might, you know, give a very bad look to your image, but you will have to just move them a bit. So you don't have to, you know, give some great effects. So for that, I've just gone down to the layers panel and then I've just clicked on the new adjustment layer and then I've just gone up and then picked up black and white adjustment layer. Okay. So this is made a new black and white layer out here and it's deeply saturated my image. Okay, my entire image has got saturated and it's in black and white, right? But I don't think I want to take it this far. I really don't want to give him a black and white look or, you know, some oldish look. Basically, I want to give him a rough look, right? So I don't want this to happen. So I'll just try applying it to the sharpness layer only. For that, what I've done is I've just pressed and hold on the Alt key on my keyboard. Then I've just clicked in between the black and white layer and the sharpen layer. I'm sure you remember whatever new adjustment layer you put up. So that particular layer will be applied to all the layers below it. Okay. To apply to only one particular layer, you will have to click on Alt. Okay. Select it. Select in between the layers and then just link them up. Okay. Excuse me. So it's basically a little more saturated, but I think, you know, a blend that's a little better, right? So it used to be very, you know, black and white previously, but now when I've just selected it with the sharpen layer, it's making it look more decent than what it used to be, right? Next step that I have followed is, here we go. By making sure that my background layer, sorry, my black and white layer is still selected here, I've just gone up to the blend modes again. And then I have selected soft light from normal. I've just made this to soft light. Okay. See, this is how my image is like going to show here. Okay, this is how my, you know, images got changed. Okay. Then to blend it even more, I've just gone to the opacity here. Okay, I've just got this down to 50%. Okay, then I felt the image looked more perfect. Okay, so here is basic comparison of how my original image is, my original image was, and how my, you know, changed image is. See the comparison here. So what I've done is, I've just pressed and hold on the Alt key on my keyboard and then I've just pressed on the eye icon next to the my background layer. I'm sure you remember this. So here we go. I've just pressed on the Alt key and then I've just pressed on the eye icon in the background layer. So normally when you press the eye icon, it means this particular layer doesn't show up here, right? So when you press Alt key on your keyboard and press on the eye icon, it only shows this particular layer, okay? It, you know, hides all the other layers, okay? It works in a reverse manner. Whenever you just press on the eye icon, it only hides that particular layer. Whenever you press on the Alt key on your keyboard and press on the eye icon, only that particular layer will be shown and all other layer will be like vanished. Okay, they will be like hidden. Okay, that will basically solo the layer, making it, you know, look prominent. Okay, so there's basically a huge difference, right? So there's much more texture and grunge with when compared to all other layers. Okay, when I look at my original layer, it looks really so soft. And using curves and mask, I was able to bring more details into this particular picture without, you know, harming the areas of the image. See, I have not changed anything. So the background is as it is. The image is also as it is. I've not really changed the colors as well, but it's just giving a more rough look to my image. Okay, this is called as grunge effect. This is really cool, right? So you've basically changed the effect of the image. Okay, so this is basically the comparison between your original layer and the new layer sharpen mask that you have just created. Okay, you know what? This actually looks like it could be like, you know, action movie poster. Okay, so I just wanted to try adding a little, you know, a small title at the bottom just to see how it basically looks. Okay, so this, you know, this man, this shaving effect, this grungy effect on his face. Okay, I just felt as if this is kind of a movie poster. So I just wanted to add some text here. So what I've done was I just gone to the tools panel here on the left, and then I've selected my type tool or text tool, I can say. Then I've just, you know, clicked on my canvas here, and then I've just, you know, typed something in some capital letters. Okay. Here I've just typed something in the capital letters, and then I've just gone and then, you know, clicked on this check mark out here. Okay, so this is basically, this check mark is basically to commit a text, and this is basically to, you know, remove the text whatever you have done. Okay, this text, but it's like completely not visible. No, it's really small, but I really can't even see like what I've typed. So here, if you see, this is what I've typed. But I was not even able to see what I have typed for that. What I have done was, I have just gone and then pressed on Control T on my keyboard. Okay, this is Control T on my keyboard to enable free transform. Okay, then I have just pressed and hold on the Shift key. Okay. I've just pressed and hold on the Shift key, and then I've just dragged this. Okay, I've just, you know, you'll find your cursor like this, and then I've just dragged it a bit. Okay, just to make sure, I'm just dragging it in a consistent manner in the same height and width ratio as it was basically made of. Okay, I'm just going to pay attention out here to my width and height. So it's basically a small thing, right? So I've just pressed on Control T. Then I've pressed on Shift key. I've just dragged that small, you know, text, or, you know, required text length. I've just, you know, made sure I just follow this width and height options out here. And then I made sure to see, set the width at 11 inches. So whenever my width was 11 inches, I've just stopped it out. Okay. Then I just, I've just gone up and then clicked on the check mark out there to just commit to my free transform. So just to tell Photoshop that I just want this to be, you know, there on my keyboard, sorry, on my canvas. Okay, I've just committed to the canvas. Now this font is all right, but it's not quite a movie font I was actually hoping for. This is just a regular font, right? Then what I have done was, I've just gone to the tool options here. I've just selected this tool options. These are all font options, right? So I've selected Arial Bold option. Okay, so Arial Bold is like real good option to just give a bold look to your text. So here we go. This is how the text got changed when I've just changed it to Arial Bold. Okay, now I just want to change its color as well, because here it's just going and blending up with my image, background image out here. The text is just blending with the image. So I just don't want this to happen. So what I've done is I've selected the, you know, color option out here. Okay, here from the tool options, I've just selected this color thumbnail. then I've just, you know, chose a nice dark red, which is like not too bright or not too dark, just the right where it is, you know, where it looks basically a bit serious. Okay, but not like, you know, over the top. Like I have not given it a red look, but I've just given a bold red look to it. Okay, so this is how my text is like looking right now after giving it some Arial bold and a red color. Okay, so I've just gone ahead and just tried to duplicate this text by pressing and holding on the Alt key. Okay, whenever I press and hold on the Alt key, and then when I just drag this text, it just gets duplicated. Okay, so this will simultaneously, of course, duplicate the text and create a new line of the text to work with. So what I've done is like it gives me shave and shave, right? So I've just double click here on the text, or I can also go ahead and double click the T icon in the text layer panel here, this T icon here. Okay, this T icon here, I can just click here, and I've just, you know, typed heart. Okay, it was shaved before, and then I've just typed heart in all the capital letters. Then I've just gone out and then I've clicked on the check mark to commit my text. Okay, here I have a check mark, right? So I've just clicked the check mark and then I've committed to my text. Now, I want the heart text. So it was shave before, so I've just, you know, renamed it to heart. So shave has 5 letters, right? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and heart just have 4 letters. So they're not matching each other, right? So I want this heart text, this hard word, to be big enough to match the shave text, right? So once again, what I've done is I've just gone to hit Control T. Okay, Control T is the free transform for the text tool option. Okay, and then I've just gone to the free transform. Then I've just resize this and sort of move it around so that I just can, you know, line it up with the top text. All that I've done is like just drag it out. That's it. I've just pressed on Control T. I've just selected this layer. And then I've just, you know, dragged it out to make it, you know, look equally similar with my shave word. So this is what I've done. And basically, you know, matching up with each other. Then I've, you know, check marked here. And just to, you know, say that I just want to commit to my text. Okay. Now. So here we go. Next, I would like them to be like vertically apart from each other about like 30 pixels, okay? So what I've done is I've just pressed and hold on the shift key. Then I've hit on the arrow, on my arrow key on the keyboard 3 times, okay? I've just pressed on the shift key and then I've just pressed 3 times here. What it does is, it basically, you know, will space them exactly 30 pixels apart. Okay. So now I have, you know, pressed it thrice. If you can see the difference. So it's basically now like, you know, attached to each other. So I've just, you know, pressed on the shift key and then pressed it thrice. So it's just giving me a nice 30 pixel space in between. Okay. Then I just wanted to make sure, you know, the text is like, you know, nicely in between. So I've just again pressed on the shift key and then I've just moved the text so that it's basically in between my canvas. So previously it was just a bit moved. So I made sure my text lies exactly in between the canvas. Okay. Now I just wanted to proceed with adding a drop shadow to them. So I just made sure that I've selected shave particular word. So every text is I've renamed it. So I've made it shave, I've made it hard. So I made sure I selected the shave, a text out here. Okay, in the layers panel. Okay, just give me a second here. Yep. So next, here we go. So I've made sure I've selected the shape layer out here. So with this shape layer selected, I've just gone down to the bottom of the layers panel, and then I've just clicked on the layer effects, okay, which is FX button. I'm sure you remember this FX button, right? This is your trash icon. This is your new layer. This is your new folder icon here. This is your mask. This is your adjustment layer. And here you've got this layer effect effects, you know, icon out here. So I've just clicked here, and then I have selected drop shadow. Okay, so now the layer style dialog box is open, and then I've just dragged it, this opacity here, if you remember, all these options. So whenever I just clicked here on the drop shadow option out here, so this particular, you know, layer box is just, you know, appeared. So a few changes I have made it to the options. I'll just quickly tell you what they are. So I've just, you know, dragged the opacity to 100% because I want a very bold shadow. Then I've just unchecked this, you know, box out here, which is a use global light option. So I've unchecked it. And then I've just gone ahead and set the angle to 90 degrees. Then I've just brought down the size to 0 pixels. And finally, I have adjust the distance slider till it's just touching the bottom of the text. See, so this is the distance here. So this is the, you know, shadow that I was actually talking about. I made sure I just, you know, drag this distance so that it touches the shadow out here. So I found it pretty good at 29 pixels. These options might be like different if you select some, you know, different image or different kind of text. But this actually worked for me. So I thought I'll just show all these options to you so that you actually know what all options to modify and what all options to remain as it is, to retain them as it is. Okay. The drop shot is like really good for me. So I've just gone up and then I've just clicked OK to apply. Okay. So it just got applied to my shave layer because my shave layer was selected. Okay. So shave text has just got the, you know, nice shadow effect. Then I want to apply this, the same, you know, shadow effect of the shave layer to the hard layer. Okay, so I just want to apply them out. So I just copied, I just want to basically copy it. So the drop shadow, I just want to copy the drop shadow to the bottom text by pressing, and I've just pressed and hold the Alt key here. And then I've just, you know, dragged down to the drop shadow effect. I've just, you know, selected it, and then I've dragged and dropped into the hard text layer in the layers panel. So basically, again, you really don't have to go and then give the same effect, you know, change all the opacity, distance, whatnot, all the options. So you really don't have to do all of that. All that you can do is press on the Alt key and then just drag and drop. The effect will be like automatically given to this particular layer as well, whichever you select. So that's basically the advantage of, you know, layer effects, I can say. Now, finally, I again wanted to make sure the text sort of leans towards the right. Okay. Almost like an italic font. Okay, I always have an option in my text tool option to give it some italic fonts or give it some underlines, or, you know, so you can strike off the text. I have all the options. Okay, the only issue using an italic one is that it won't line up with the text the way I really want it to. Okay, so I really don't want to use that italic option directly. So what I have done is I have done it manually. So first I have pressed and hold on the shift key, then I've selected both my layers. Okay, here if you can see, I've selected both shape and the hard layers. Then I just right clicked and then converted them to smart object here. Okay, convert to smart object. Here we go. Okay, I've just selected, you know, both the layers, shape and hard. I've just right clicked on one layer and then I've selected the convert to smart object option. And to skew these, I just wanted to skew them up. Okay, to skew this, I've just gone to edit. I've just gone to transform and then I've just, you know, clicked on skew option out here. I've, you know, selected both my text layers into smart objects, and then with my both text layers selected, I've just gone to edit, I've just gone to transform, and then I've just gone to skew. Okay, this is place, this basically placed the text in a sort of a free transformation box, if you see here out here. Okay, this box basically appears a bit differently. Okay, see, you have some cross mark here, so you have whatever text is there is completely selected, but this box functions a little bit differently. Okay, so what I have done was press and hold on the alt key. Okay, and then I've just dragged it up. I've just, you know, moved this a bit on the top line here. I've just, you know, pointed here. I've tilted it right a bit. Okay, but I have not dragged it too much to the right, but I have just made sure here you can find the degrees of it as well. Okay, I've just stopped it whenever I have seen 9 degrees. Okay, so this is called basically a skew, SKEW. Okay, so whenever I found this at 9 degrees, I've just stopped this out. Then I just, you know, hit enter on my keyboard to commit to the transform. Okay, so this is how, so this second image, this is how it basically looked after my transformation. I've just, you know, given it some nice bold effect. Then I've just, you know, I've first changed the color of, we have changed the, font type. Then we have changed the color. Then we have just given the shadow effect to it. Then we have just copied the shadow effect to the hard text as well. Then we just wanted to, you know, skew this up, you know, give some italic kind of look to this. So we have just, you know, gone to edit, transform, and then we have just gone to skew. And then we have made sure, I have basically made sure to, you know, tilt this to the 9 degrees. 9 degrees was like quite good for me. So I've just made this and then I've, you know, put this to 9 degrees. So here you will find a small dot out here. By pressing here, you can just tilt it out. Then after 9 degrees, I've just stopped it out, and then it really looked good for me. Then I've clicked on enter on my keyboard to commit to the transformation. Now you can see the difference. I've just put, you know, the original image out here and the final transformed image. See how different they look, right? So we have gone from a manly yet soft image to a hard, gritty movie poster with a grunge effect, right? So this is how we have, you know, changed a nice, soft, you know, a man to a, you know, rough looking, grungy, affected man, right? So we have also tried to play around with the text as well. So this is it for the grunge effect. So in tomorrow's session, we'll just try to understand one more, you know, a photo editing technique. I'm sure you're all practicing all of this. So that's the reason for, you know, going forward sessions. I'm just trying to put up in the PPT. And I want you to parallelly do whatever, you know, I'm telling in the session, so that it will be a nice practice for you all. If you have any queries in this session, please put forward. Okay, thanks for all the time. So just try to practice whatever we have done in today's session. It's really interesting and funny. Just try to pick up some other image and then just try to work out. If you have any doubts, please feel free to, you know, contact or, you know, let me know in the next session. So we'll just wrap this around. We'll connect tomorrow, guys. Thank you. Thanks for all your time.